of Radiant Kids TV. Once again, we're so glad that you're here with us. We've got a bit of a different story this week as we continue to learn about the early church in the book of Acts. So stick with us because here we go.
Hi, Radiant Kids! Stand up on your feet, it's time to sing!
Our story this week focuses on a couple of interesting people in the book of Acts. Their names were Ananias and Sapphira, or Sapphira. Hard to know exactly how she pronounced it.
It does.
But it ties in with our big picture question this week, which is, what is the church? Johnny, would you like to read what the church is?
Okay. The church is all Christians everywhere who gather together in their communities to worship and serve God.
That's right. All Christians everywhere.
Yeah. All Christians everywhere because they know Jesus.
Yeah. So the church isn't just about a building. The church is people.
Yeah, a church is about people who know God.
Yeah, people who love God and want to obey Him. So there are local churches like Mountain View Alliance Church who gather together in specific communities where members live. There's also the global church, think all over the world, which is every single believer across the whole world and even all of the believers throughout history, which is really incredible to think about, isn't it?
Yeah, it does.
So we've been learning about the very early days of Jesus' church after Jesus ascended into heaven and sent the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came to live with believers, and right away they began preaching the good news and living on mission. They gave generously, they worshiped God, they took care of the poor, and they taught others how to obey God. But the early church had some problems too, and we are going to watch a story about that.
The early church was growing. By the power of the Holy Spirit, the apostles were telling people that Jesus had been raised from the dead. A large group of believers met together in Jerusalem. They shared everything they had. If someone had more than he needed, he gladly gave it away so everyone had what he needed. One man, Barnabas, sold a field and gave the money to the apostles. The apostles used the money to help people in need. Everyone who had land or houses did the same. Ananias and his wife, Sapphira, sold some land and pretended to give all of the money to the apostles, but they kept some of it for themselves. When Ananias brought the money to the apostles, Peter asked him, "Why are you lying to the Holy Spirit? You could have been honest about what you did with the money, but instead you lied, not to us, but to God." When Ananias heard this, he fell down, died, and was buried. Everyone who heard about this was filled with fear. About 3 hours later, Sapphira came to the apostles. She did not know what had happened to her husband. Peter asked her, "Is this all the money you got for the land?" "Yes," she said, "that's all of it." Peter said, "Why did you and your husband agree to test the Lord?" Then Sapphira fell dead too. Great fear came on everyone in the church and all who heard about these things. Ananias and Sapphira wanted to look generous, but they were greedy. The Holy Spirit changes our hearts to want to share with those in need because Jesus generously gave all he had so we can share in his riches and have forgiveness and eternal life.
That is quite the story. Now, there are two main things that I want us to think about as we consider it. One is how Ananias and Sapphira actually sinned and what it means to fear God. Ananias and Sapphira were not sinning by keeping some of the money back from the land that they sold.
Yeah.
Peter even told them that the money was theirs to do whatever they wanted to with it. The issue was that they were lying about it. They were lying about the money and said that they gave it all when really they hadn't.
Yeah.
They were trying to appear generous when in their hearts they really weren't. They were wanting to keep the money for themselves. Which brings us to the next idea. What does it really mean to fear God? We've talked about this a little bit in some other episodes, but when the Bible talks about fearing God, it's not the kind of fear that you're thinking of, right? It's like when you're afraid of our dog running away, or afraid of...
Like, afraid of Katie running away.
Yeah, or afraid of bears in the forest or something like that, right?
Or afraid of spiders crying up.
Or spiders, exactly. The fear of the Lord is about understanding His power and His holiness. We fear the Lord when we love and respect Him and desire to honor Him with our lives.
And we need to love Him because He's God. He needs protecting the world.
He's protecting the world. That's true. God is powerful and hates sin. And people who try to oppose Him will fail and be separated from Him. God will protect His people from their enemies, like you just said.
Yeah, like we protect our people.
Yeah.
But
fearing God means understanding how dangerous it is to be an enemy of His.
And we don't be enemies, because we have to be loving enemies.
Yes, we have to love our enemies too. That's right. So fearing God means we want to be His children by having faith in Jesus. Ananias and Sapphira lied to God, and their deaths spread the fear of God through the early church, strengthening believers. Mm-hmm. Giving generously is an honor and a great source of joy. God isn't interested in forcing us to give away money that we don't want to give away. God wants us to see the beauty of His generosity and understand that He will provide for all of our needs.
And He protects the kingdom, God protects everyone from being afraid.
Yeah. So God wants us to be generous as the Holy Spirit grows us to be more like Jesus. Our generosity should come from our love of God and our desire to see His mission fulfilled. Now, Simi, what are we going to watch next?
It's time for questions from kids.
You got it.
Hi there, I'm Pastor Brian, and it's time for Questions from Kids. Naomi from Lake Charles, Louisiana asks,
when I give money to my church, where does it go?
Good question, Naomi. You know, in today's Bible story, we saw that Ananias and Sapphira lied about their gift of what they gave to the church. And so it causes that question, well, what does happen to the money that we give to church? But before I kind of talk about that for a minute or so, let me say this really clearly up front. God doesn't need our money. Everything is already His. So I don't want us to think that God is so needy that, you know, we have to give Him our money or else He's going to be in a world of hurt. No, we give because it's good for us, and God invites us to join in with what He's doing in our church and around the world. And so that's really what giving to church is all about. Where does that money go? Well, it goes to support all the ministries of your church, all the ministries it does for adults and teenagers and kids and preschoolers, to grow in our faith, to serve our communities, and share the gospel around the world. Think about it. Even something as simple as turning the lights on and paying for the utility bill, helping to pay for your pastor's salary so that he can continue to serve faithfully, to think about the curriculum that you have, like the Gospel Project. All these things cost money, and you giving to the church helps support all of that. So this is why giving is an act of worship. We should give as a way to tell Jesus we love Him and we value Him. And that's why in the New Testament it says that we are to give cheerfully, generously, and even sacrificially, to give more than we may feel comfortable giving at times, because we're trusting that God will do better things with our money than we would. So we know that God can do great things through what we give. And even now, if you don't have much money, you can still give. Let me encourage you. You probably don't have a job, but you might get an allowance. So give of that allowance to the church. Or maybe you get birthday and Christmas money. Give some of that money to the church. It's not the amount that matters, but the heart behind it that matters. And I want you to experience the joy of investing your money, as well as your time and your energy, into the great things God is doing through your local church. So here's a question back for you. What is your attitude about giving your time or your money, and why?
The first churches had a lot to learn about how to honor Jesus and how to do right by others. Which brings us to our story point today, that Ananias and Sapphira lied about their gift to the church. They needed the Holy Spirit to change their hearts so that they would do what is right. And that brings us to our Bible verse today, our key passage. John, would you do me the honor of reading that for me?
Do you want to read it with us?
We saw
many
in Christ, and individually members of one another.
So, thank you. We, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Paul's letter to the Roman believers contains one of the most clear explanations of the gospel. Our key passage comes near the end of that book of Romans, where Paul reminds believers what it means to be a part of the church. The church is united as one body, working together for God's glory and for our good. Even though individuals are all created uniquely by God to be wonderful and special creations, we all work together as one church, and we all work best together when we are together.
Let's pray.
Father God, you are the giver of all good gifts. Everything we have comes from you. Lord, we confess we are greedy. We think of our own desires before the needs of others. Change our hearts to be generous like Jesus. Give us joy in giving to others. Amen.
Amen.
Stand up and sing again,
Ready Kids.
I raise a hallelujah. Hallelujah, louder than the unbelief.
Hi everyone, welcome back to another Experiments with a Purpose. Now, as the weather outside is heating up, we are going to too at Experiments with a Purpose, and we are going to be using matches for our next two experiments. Now, for the first one today, I'm going to ask Noah to come up and share a Bible verse with us.
For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-discipline. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Noah. Now, did you hear what Noah said? For God has not given us a spirit of fear. All right. Now, what does fear look like? I'm going to have Chloe come and give us our fear. Now, this is the experiment with a purpose bottle of fear. Da, da, da. Now, what does fear feel like? Now, when you have to hold up a big, heavy bottle of water, or you're weighed down by a big, heavy bottle of water, can you jump really high? Or can you do the things that you want to? I want you to think about a time that you have been afraid of something. Do you think that helps you to do something, or it doesn't help you to do something? You're probably saying it doesn't, right? Well, that's right. Sometimes when we're gripped by fear, it makes us not to be able to do the things that God wants us to do. Now, in the verse, we also talked about power, love, and self-discipline. Now, what does that look like? I'm going to have Noah give us power, love, and self-discipline. And it's going to be these three matches. Now, in today's experiment, I'm going to show you how three matches can overcome a big bottle of fear. You're kind of going, what? Three tiny matches and a giant bottle of fear? Now, this is an experiment that you can try at home, and all you need is three matches, a piece of rope tied to a water bottle, and I'm going to set this up over here, and I'm going to show you how to do it. And I want you guys to try it at home too with your parents. And you can even do this with toothpicks. It's a little bit easier with matches because they have like a rough head that you can wedge it with. But through the power of TV, we're going to speed this up for you, because I'm going to try this and I'm going to fail a bunch of times, but I don't have to be afraid of failing. I'm just going to try this a bunch of times and I'll show you what it looks like afterwards. All right? Here we go! All right, kids. Well, no one said that overcoming fear was easy. Oh, that was a lot of takes. I think we probably did that about 20, 30 times to get it just right. But we have to remember that in the right proportions, what did 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7 say? For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and self-discipline. Now, if we use and we put all three in just the right amount, something amazing happens. I'm gonna lift up the end and look at that. Our three matches is able to overcome fear. With just three matches and a little perseverance, we no longer have to have a spirit of fear. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's experiment with a purpose, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
It's birthday time.
We have one birthday this week.
Happy birthday to Chelsea Burnett.
Happy birthday, Chelsea.
Happy birthday.
We hope you have a great day celebrating. Thanks everyone for watching Radiant Kids this week. We hope you turn in again next time for
Radiant Kids.
You betcha. Have a great week, everyone.
Bye.